of Solutions to Results LLC, a consulting firm that helps practices and organizations in the areas of communication, culture, education, and training. Today, I'm happy to have David Bergstein, Chief Innovation Officer at Bergstein CPA. David, who has been a major voice in the CPA profession, was previously with Intuit as a manager of vendor relations. Previous to that, he held high-level positions at three accounting provider software companies. He's also an adjunct professor at Valencia College and holds the CPA, CGMA, and CITP designations. He's been a recipient of numerous awards given by associations and publications, and he's the leading voice on the use of technology by CPA firms and how firms need to position themselves in the future in this new work environment. So, welcome, David, and thank you for participating. The accounting profession faces challenges: technology, partner retirement, globalization, and competition from other sectors. And now, on top of everything else, you add this global pandemic. Many changes in the way businesses will operate, how they will develop business, how they will position themselves for the future. So what does this all mean? Just give us a big picture perspective of the accounting profession in terms of who will be the major players in the future in this uncertain world.
Okay. First, thank you for having me today. I appreciate it. And who will be the major players in this world? It's a good question, an interesting question. And I don't think we will see anything drastically change. As you look at the global landscape, and I just looked at statistics that just came out, there are 658,267 actively licensed CPAs in the U.S. And when you break these down, there's some in private, there's some in public, there's some in government. But when you look at the public accounting sector, which is what you're really asking the question about, who's going to be the big players, there's somewhere between 42, 43,000 public accounting firms out there. Number one firm, Deloitte, has over 65,000 people working from $21 billion in revenue. When you drop down to number 100, it's $43 million in revenue. When you drop down to 300, you're looking at $8 million. When you look at number 400, you're talking about $2 to $4 million. And then you got 41,600 plus other firms that are sole practitioners. So global landscape, you can have the big, which are getting bigger because of mergers and acquisitions, and the small, the solo practitioners like me, we're not going away until we retire. But there's a lot of baby boomers retiring every day, but there's new people coming into the profession. But the question is, will the new people become CPAs or just business coaches, business consultants? Because what makes a CPA stand out from the crowd is the fact that they can do the audit, they have the attest capabilities, and the audit will always be there, but there's much more opportunity in advisory services. And why do I say advisory services? And then I'll stop with my run-on long answer, which covers everything. Why advisory services? Because the bulk of the profession does compliance work when you talk about small to medium firms. People come to me or other CPAs, help me grow my business, but I need to do tax returns. I got sales tax returns. I got payroll tax returns. I don't know how to do accounting, so you got to help me do it so I can do the tax return at the end of the year. So that's compliance work. But compliance work is being overtaken by automation, and this is where the changes are. So as super large firms employing automation, a solo practitioner can employ automation. The actual advantage is to the smaller firm to employ automation, because the larger firm is like an ocean liner. When it's changing and turning what it's doing, it's got to get more people to agree and slower to turn. The smaller the firm, the faster they can adopt automation, and that can change how a CPA works and what they bill for in the future.
But the same token, the smaller firms have less financial resources with which to turn the ship, as it were, and to diversify its holdings. As you said, the franchise that CPAs have is the attest function. Now, the only way that the small and mid-sized firms can become more competitive is through the efficient use of technology, saving up the time that they have used for compliance work and provide value-added services. So this is a challenge for them to enter into new avenues that they haven't done before. So how are they going to leap over or at least keep up with the larger firms who've been providing business advice, business coaching for a lot more years?
Well, it's an interesting point you make. The larger firms have been doing it, but The smaller firms don't necessarily compete with the super large firms. The smaller firms compete with the non-CPAs, the people that are going into the business with business acumen and financial backing to some extent. They'll hire CPAs or accountants to work for them. What's going to distinguish and how I'm going to be able to compete is I have to show people that I'm more capable than a non-CPA to help them grow their business, be more liquid, be more solvent, and be more profitable. I have to rely on the fact that I am a CPA, required to take continuing education, which other people are too. But CPAs have a very high ranking in the list of trust, and it has to do with ethical standards, even though there are breakdowns of CPAs getting arrested every once in a while for fraudulent activities. So I am not going to compete with the big firms. I'm going to compete with the small to medium firms and the non-CPA firms, and I have to parlay or market my expertise and the fact that I'm a licensed CPA who is licensed by the state of Florida in this particular case, and I have high ethical standards. So why choose me over someone else? Because I'm a CPA, licensed, and highly ethical, and required to continue to look out for the client.
So I'm a small business owner. I'm looking to expand. As far as I'm concerned, and this is just me talking, but I think I might be representative of a larger group out there, that I really don't care about your continuing professional education or your ethics. I mean, I do care about your ethics, but I want to know about how you're going to uncover opportunities for me and walk me through how I can take advantage of those opportunities. So I know from the stereotypical understanding of CPAs that they do financial statements, they do tax returns, but I want to know something simple as, I have a car wash and I'm looking to franchise. Mr. CPA, what do you think about that? Can you help me do it? Now, what happens, you know, this is like running into a brick wall. My CPA has never encountered a question like this from me. What's my expectations?
I like the question, by the way, because that brings me back to a book I just co-authored with Jeff Brandeis, because this is before anybody can be an accountant or a consultant for someone. It comes down to a sales presentation. I have to sell my services above someone else's. And you're asking the perfect question. How can I help you? The perfect answer is not for me to say I can help you. My perfect answer is to say, please, I think we can help you, but I need to understand more about what you're doing. And I need to understand what your needs are and what you're looking at, why you're looking at it before I can give you an answer. And one of the best things that I do based on my CPA training is I'm able to analyze the situation and help you develop a business plan if we're going to go into franchising across the board. But let me understand a little bit more about your opportunity. Tell me what your opportunity is, Mr. Sachs. Tell me why you're asking that question, and let me tell you why I can help you better than anybody else if I understand more what you're doing and be able to answer that. Does that make sense to you, Mr. Sachs?
It makes sense theoretically, but what about those who've been in the profession for X number of years who have been used to doing compliance work, very little consulting? How do you get them, take them from a rather narrow myopic view of getting the work done to opportunities? I mean, there is a sales pitch, I understand that, but how do you get them to be more entrepreneurial, to look for the opportunities as they're undertaking the compliance work that they've been engaged to do?
Well, you're going to have to continue to do the compliance work. And there's something called the e-myth. You know, I shouldn't be, as a sole practitioner, working in the business constantly. I should be working on the business, helping to structure my organization to help other people. So how do you do that? You do that by changing what you do. It's all about change. Barry Melanson keeps telling CPAs, you got to relearn, re-educate, learn, forget, and start over again. And for all those CPAs that are out there a long time, hey, you have to change and adapt because the world is changing. You know, I'm guessing 5 years from now, nobody will write a check out to pay a bill. How do you pay your bills now, Mr. Sachs?
It's a combination of writing out bills and online banking.
Right, because right now there's still a combination, but 5 years from now, there'll be more tools out there to do payment share, spend money, and save it. So that's what's really happening. If the people who are CPAs now or doing accounting don't realize they have to change, then they're not going to change. So who will survive after this pandemic, which has created a tremendous amount of business opportunities for accountants, because everybody was coming to their accountant not to get the tax return done in February, March, and April. They were coming saying, hey, I got a small business. I need to stay afloat. Help me. This pandemic actually pushed accounting firms into doing much more in the way of advisory services. They may not have charged for it, but now as accountants start to realize they got to do now for after the pandemic, they got to change their pricing model. They got to go from an hourly pricing model to, I'll call it, a fixed pricing model or a value pricing model, where they give clients choices about package A, package B, and package C. So I can't change the mindset of people that say, I'm going to do the compliance, but the people who do the compliance and don't do anything else will lose the compliance work because automation is taking over. And how is automation taking over? And let's talk about Intuit, which I think is a great company. TurboTax gets smarter and smarter each year for helping people go through the tax process. And it's helping accountants because what they do on the consumer side helps them automate their tax practice to help tax professionals capture the data automatically, move the information through the system, and allows the accountant to do more advisory services. The same thing from a QuickBooks or a Xero side. Consumer gets a business and says, hey, I got to do some work. They go out and buy a package. They don't know how to use it. But as an accountant, you should be offering services to train your client on how to use their automation tools.
What happens if over time the clients or potential clients become a little bit more sophisticated and they understand these packages and they implement them themselves and they do it? So now it sort of cuts out the CPA from at least that part of engaging the client, helping them set up the books and learning to do this. So now they're going to have to go to an outside business advisor, whether it be a CPA or non-CPA, and say, don't worry about my books. I got them taken care of. This is what I want to do. So there's going to be greater competition. That moniker, the CPA, is not going to mean as much anymore versus somebody who's come in, let's say has an MBA, understands business operations and understands marketing and other forms of business advice. What do you say about that situation?
Goodbye. Have a nice day. No, I'm only kidding. That again comes back to the same thing. You have to sell yourself versus the other person. So someone's got an MBA. Great. I've got a lot of business acumen. I understand how financial decisions are made. And again, it still comes back, and you're asking that question again, that comes back to a selling situation. If I don't have the expertise for something, one of the beauties of being a member of the FICPA, the Florida Institute of Certified Public Accountants, is I have a network of people that I can buddy with, which means I can send work to and still keep the client. And it comes back to you as the accountant, understanding the situation. So, okay, Mr. Sachs, you said you can handle the books. That's great. But you want advice on whether to buy this business or to not buy this business or whatever your question might be is. I'll give you some advice, but let's understand what your situation is first. Do you have the resources to be able to buy this business? Do you need to borrow money? Do you have investors? How do you plan to organize this operation? Do you have a business plan for what you're doing? I can help you with all of that, but we still need to make sure your books are in order. How do you do your tax returns now? Do you do them by yourself or do you have another accountant?
Are you asking me as a business owner?
I'm asking you rhetorically as part of you asking this question as a business owner.
Let's say I do my return myself through TurboTax.
Okay, great. You know, wouldn't you like me to help you and look at this to make sure you're taking advantage of everything as we plan for the future? Again, I am going to compete with the MBA. I'm going to compete with the non-CPA firm across the board. But again, it still comes back to drawing a line of sand. I think smaller CPA firms have a harder time advertising their expertise. But I don't have a niche. I'm a generalist. I'm not looking to develop a niche. I'm not actually looking to grow my CPA practice, but most CPAs will develop a niche. And I see a lot of younger CPAs out there. I'm an expert in the brewery business as an accountant. I've been working with X number of breweries. I can help you be more efficient, more profitable, leaner, more solvent. And I work specialized in this industry. So that's what it comes down to moving forward. Everything is subject to gains and losses as a CPA firm. We're actually talking less about culture, less about diversity, but the future of the profession is drastically changing. Even during this pandemic, people are not seeing doctors in person. How are they seeing doctors now? Teledoc, on video, just like this conference is. And what's taking over to telling them how the doctor, how the person is? They're using the tools of automation. They're using some information off iPhones, some other information off automatic blood pressure machines. So you can look at your stuff and know what your situation is, but you may not know how to solve the problem. And that's why you look for someone who has expertise.
Well, shifting gears for a second, we're talking about people who are already in the profession X number of years, whether CPAs or not CPAs, and they're helping clients. Let's talk about education. So the firms are no longer looking for people who have the usual audit and accounting background. They're looking for those finance and, of course, technology in such areas as artificial intelligence and data analytics and cybersecurity and such. What will universities, undergraduate and graduate schools for that matter, in accounting and business, how will they have to change their curriculum to resemble more of the way business is going to be operated both domestically and globally over the next 10 years? And more specifically, how will the CPA exam change?
Great question. And I happen to have in front of me an article from the Journal of Accountancy, which says there's going to be a new exam coming into place in January 2024. Under the new licensure model, this is from the Journal of Accountancy, each CPA candidate will be required to exhibit core skills in accounting, auditing, tax, and technology, which is really core plus some kind of discipline. In addition, each candidate will be required to show more depth and skills in the following areas. So we got our tax, we got our audit, we got our accounting and technology, tax compliance and planning. That's more on the planning side. Business reporting and analysis, and information systems and control. So universities will still have a typical theoretical approach to audit, to tax, to accounting. But more and more, and as I teach at Valencia College in Florida, more and more of the students, I'm telling them, have to have a broader knowledge than accounting. They have to have technology skills. If they want to specialize in computers, cybersecurity is an area. But every decision, this is a key which people forget, and I firmly believe this, every decision that people make in business typically relate back to accounting. They relate to an income statement, they relate to a balance sheet, they relate to a statement of cash flow. You can make decisions based on, even when someone's making a personal decision, it still comes back to an accounting decision as to do they have the resources to do something. So I think more and more colleges will keep basic programs, but then they're going to develop more of these technical courses where people become experts in automation, experts in data analytics. They're going to be teaching the tools and how to use the tools. But in order to use the tools, you have to understand the basics of what you're trying to do, which is improve your assets, lower your liabilities, improve your cash flow, improve your net worth, improve revenue, reduce expenses. So accounting underlies all of that, no matter what you do.
So couldn't you sort of say that the earning the CPA or the path toward earning the CPA is sort of like the undergraduate, the umbrella, but then the master's level, if you will, would be the specialized area? If you wanted to specialize, let's say, in data analytics or artificial intelligence and get a designation, a credential in that area, would that be like a separate master's level? Would that be the fifth year as we know it to be, in college? Well, how will that framework exist?
Well, I think that framework already exists. The AICPA is giving digital badges out now. What are the digital badges out for? They're out for a badge that data analytics, a badge that know all these different specifics. I don't think it's a five-year education. I have a master's in tax. I don't go around telling people I have a master's in tax. I tell people I'm a CPA. I can help you with your business. What do you need? What's keeping you up at night? Tell me the story. Why are you looking to change what you're doing? What seems to be the issues? And then maybe after listening to the issues, I can figure out what they need and then present back to them how I can help them overcome the obstacles that are in front of them. Can I do it by myself? Not necessarily. I might need the services of a tech company. I might need the services of another expert. But again, I do believe when you tell someone you're a CPA versus a non-CPA, they look at you a certain way in making their judgment decision of who they're going to work with. There's a lot more to it than say, I'm a CPA and I can do it for you, versus, hey, I'm a business advisor and this is what I've been doing and how I can do it. So it still comes down to, no matter what your title is, a relevant sales pitch. But again, you can't deliver unless you have the knowledge or the assistance. Even something, large firms advertise cost segregation services to help people expense items a lot quicker than capitalizing and depreciating. You know, smaller firms haven't thought about that much unless they think about advisory services. So if I get a large client that I see an opportunity, I'm going to bring in the experts to work with me. I don't have to have it, but I know who the experts are.
Switching gears, you talked a little bit briefly before about diversity and inclusion. I want to talk about, since there are changes in the profession and now we're forced to work differently, what about in the future there'll be less bricks and mortar, as it were, and more of a remote working environment? What do you think is going to be the biggest impact on accountants in working in this new normal, if you will, in terms of their role, communications, being able to supervise other people? And there are a lot of other areas that are involved in this. So what does it mean going forward for the accounting profession if we're going to be looking at a remote working environment as a regular standard operating procedure?
Well, the question you asked doesn't just apply to the accounting industry. It applies to everybody. When I say accounting industry, I mean the accounting profession per se. But it applies to everybody. I can't reach out and shake your hand. We can't fist bump anywhere along the line. So you have to find new ways to collaborate, new ways to get close to people. Maybe that means after this call, we're talking more on a social level. You know, you have to bond with people you're working with. It's a little harder when it's totally remote. I just spoke to a person at a firm in the Massachusetts area yesterday. It's probably a firm somewhere between 100 and 200 people, which you put it up there, I think, in the top 400 accounting firms. I asked him, you know, okay, you're going back to the office. Well, he's a high-level person. He's going back, I think, twice a week. They haven't brought everybody else back yet. And they're bringing people in and out, and they're thinking more about hoteling. I said, are you going to think about less real estate in the future? They're actually thinking of more real estate, smaller offices throughout the Boston, Massachusetts area, and people bring people into a hoteling-type environment so they can say they have more locations throughout the state of Massachusetts, if that makes sense. And that's the same if you're a stockbroker. If you're in a facility where you're doing any kind of advisory or processing services, where people, one of the things about accountants and lawyers, they don't all have to be in the same office. I'm sitting here right now, I got three screens in front of me. I can ignore you and look at the screen on the right, but I won't. So people are gonna get used to collaborating more online. It's changing the way people work, and the pandemic's forcing it, but people aren't going to get rid of real estate quick. And then I talked to someone in Manhattan yesterday. I said, it's a small office. They're in a three-story building downtown Manhattan, one of the smaller buildings. That's not a big office building. I said, how's it been going? Person commutes from Connecticut. Said the commuter train is fairly empty, that she was nervous when she was starting it. Even the subway's fairly empty. And downtown by the South Street Seaport, she's never had anybody other than herself in the elevator, even though it's only three stories. You can't walk up, but you can walk down. It's changing the way people work. Even if that person and another person, a partner of an accounting firm I talked to in Upper East Side of Manhattan, her office is in a 35-story office building. I think she's gone in twice to pick up stuff. But you can't have everybody go back, because how do you get all these people up in the elevator? I just think everything's changing. But in reality, this was all predicted a long time ago. What do you mean by that, David? It was predicted a long time ago by George Jetson, And we think about the Jetsons and the video screens and the newspapers online. You know, even Uber, when Uber's going to have its drones or its flying from place A to place B, things are changing. We have to adapt.
Well, since you seem to be an aficionado of George Jetson, what was his dog's name?
I don't know. You tell me.
Astro.
See that?
See, if you're going to go ahead and speak with some sort of authority about something, you need to see the big picture. You know his wife's name?
Nope.
Jane.
See, and I do know those names when you say them, but they were irrelevant to what I was saying. So I'm just picturing the big picture of what George Jetson was flying around in.
So what you're saying is that you think that that's how we will be commuting in the future?
Well, I slowly see that happening. Not that I really get into the deep part of it, but people take these helicopters from Manhattan to the Hamptons, smaller and smaller type of vehicles of communication. I've gotten to the point where I bought an electric bicycle. People are now commuting on e-bikes or taking their e-bikes on the subway so they don't have to get on the buses if they're taking a commuter rail. In the 1800s, did we ever think of these things? Did Jules Verne think of what might possibilities be? And again, I'll say the same thing about George Jetson across the board. Again, because I'm used to watching the TV show. We can't imagine what we don't know. But I do think everything is changing and everything will be different.
Well, the only George that I know who saw the future and shockingly accurate in its depiction is George Orwell. But I digress. One last thing I wanted to ask you about, since we talked about the way the profession is changing and the types of skill sets that are needed and the type of education and the testing and the competition, what about in terms of how CPAs will go about marketing the service? I'm not talking about an elevator pitch, but what about the marketing and what about value billing? Because we know that CPAs in the past have been reticent about billing, and I know there's been a lot of controversy around the concept of value billing. So could you walk us, clear out the dust, walk us through this and tell us where we're headed in terms of billing in the future?
Okay, well, first of all, people will not say value billing. They'll say value pricing. Value billing means you do it after the fact. Value pricing means you set it up front and you're gonna see more and more. I used to say value billing all the time, but it's really about value pricing. Establish up front that you might be a possible client for me. Let me take you through the different types of services we have. We have the bronze, silver, gold, different type services, depending what you need from us. We can help you automate or we can do more advisory services. Well, it depends what you need. And right now you sound like you don't need the gold service. You sound like you know a little bit about XYZ, so let's take you down the silver path, if that's the case. I'm not going to suggest what you think. I'm going to ask you. But that's how it's going to be sold in the future. Because you can't bill anyone by the hour anymore. Because what you used to bill by the hour might take you 10 minutes now. So it's got to be billing by your knowledge, the service you can render, and how you can help someone make better decisions. So I think it's all going to be about value pricing at a point in time. How long will it take to get there? I see it more and more. People are calling it, instead of value pricing, they're going to say, this is our monthly price, because more and more firms are saying to the client, tax returns just a deliverable to you. The financial statements are just a deliverable to you. We're going to work with you on a monthly, semi-monthly, weekly, quarterly basis. You need the controller services. You need the CFO services. We're going to bill you monthly. They're going to take your credit card up front. So they get their money because they want to make sure they have their cash flow. Again, taking the pandemic out of this and the fact that people are hurting for money right now, I see that coming just as a natural progression. Does that answer the question?
It answers the question. I also want to attach another question because it sounds like you were covering a little bit about client accounting services when you were talking about outsourcing and doing a lot of the work for the client on a monthly basis or weekly basis. Talk briefly about this new trend that's appearing in the profession called client accounting services. And is it something that's just a rebranding of the type of services that CPAs should have been providing their clients through the years?
I'll call it a rebranding because when I first started in accounting, speaking of props, we used to do write-up services and we worked from journals to ledgers, and now everything's digital. But realize a couple of things. What does any business person, including an accountant, want? They want recurring revenue. So client accounting services is a great way to get recurring revenue because you're selling it by the month, by the week, annually. Same thing with tax returns now. And that's why tax advisory is and tax planning is starting to take off. Also, it's around the same rate. You don't want your client to think of you, hey, once a year tax return. You want them to think of you as their advisor to help them with any financial literacy questions they have. Wealth management, budgeting, elder care. They sure want to go on to college. They need to create trusts. You know, they need to move money around and protect themselves. Well, all of this relates to, and I think we have something called the family office in certain accounting firms, where it's mainly for wealthy people up front. Well, it could be for anybody. You can need to come to our family office where we can help you and your family come up with a budget. And as part of this package, we'll get your tax return at the end of the year. But here's the benefits to you if we put you on this. We're going to put you on a thrift plan. You're going to put money away in your bank account or your 401k or your IRA. We're going to get you to save so you can plan for your future. So it's all about recurring revenue. Client accounting, which has been big. And again, when you think of accountants thinking of only compliance work, people would come in with their shoebox at the end of the year or the end of the month. You do the bank reconciliation. Well, that's all after the fact. You don't need to do it that way anymore. You can set them up where they get bank feeds, no matter what the accounting program is they're using. You want to give your clients real-time dashboards so they know where they are. So they don't have to call you to say, hey, am I overdrawing or whatever? You're providing them with the dashboards that are coming up on your portal. So they're coming to you when they see that, and they're seeing other information. You're giving them access. Instead of going to the bank, they're coming to you to see what their bank balance is, because you're giving them so much more than that. But that's the change in accounting right now.
Absolutely. Well, David, I have to thank you for providing your insight, how CPAs should start to think about the future, the challenges, the competition, and all the change agents that appear to be creating a perfect storm for practitioners. So much opportunity, so many things to think about. And I'm very happy to hear it from an expert who's been out in the trenches dealing with these things for ages. So I thank you very much, David, for providing your expertise. And I'm sure our audience will appreciate it as well.
I thank you for having me here. I don't like to say that I'm an expert. I've just got a lot of knowledge in my domain bank up here. There's lots of people that know a lot more than I do across the board. I'm at that stage in life where I want to help other people. And I think the opportunities are out there for anybody that wants to become an accountant to seize the opportunity and get the knowledge of what accounting is all about, and then take that knowledge and whether they're going to be a marketing manager somewhere or a finance major someplace else, use the skills of what we teach accountants so they understand the flow of information to make sure they make the right decisions.
Absolutely. Very helpful. Well, thank you very much again, David. Take care now.